So we will now concentrate only on the parts that we are able to measure. The most important, or I think that the most relevant results comes mostly from the part that Semi has concentrated, so I will concentrate on the introduction. And he will present a little bit of the results on networking and how is the network working. So in 1988, UNU-MERIT was founded. 1 year later was UNU-MERIT, now we are celebrating the 25th anniversary of UNU-MERIT, because since the 25th anniversary of UNU-MERIT was last year. Since the whole program started as a, first as a master program, and there was a moment that UNU-MERIT decided they really wanted to offer a PhD, so they converted the master program into a PhD. It was at the time where I think it started. It was taking over for 2 years by Bad Verspagen. And then Robin go on to get in 1999, and everything was the one who collected on the merit side. On the index side, at that time, there was Maria Ines Bastos, was the director of the PhD program. It was taken by Suleimani and Wadia Leapelo, and then the whole merger between merit and merit and UNU index happened, so we became all UNU-MERIT in 2010. UNU-MERIT merged with the Master School of Governance. Now, we have constrained ourselves, mostly, probably even on cities, we are not evaluating really what has happened after 2008, because we didn't have, like, we are concentrated only on those students who already graduated, okay? We are not looking at the people who are in the process, because we have to put a limit somewhere. Here is not included also School of Governance, because at the beginning we only look at merit, e-tech, and then, but I mean, changes can be introduced, but we are only looking at UNU-MERIT. So, since we started, there were 2,039 applications, out of which 169 people were accepted into the program. It's quite a big number. But, so it means 8% of the people who apply actually got into the program. Now, if you look from 2008 up to 2008, it's only 91 that were accepted. Why did we split? Because out of the 91 that have been up to 2008, only 41 has actually graduated. Now, this means a successful rate of 45%. There is a lot of people which is in the pipeline, so probably the number will increase quite quickly. What is even, what is a little bit more surprising is also this, we have, in total we have 85 people who have graduated, 44 who are PhD students from merit, but they were not part of the program. What does it mean? We have something like 44 people who never were part of the program, but they also got the PhD associated to the institution UNU-MERIT, because they were working with professors that were working for merit, but they were never part of the following all the courses. Now, the average time that they took us from the program to complete was around 6 years. There's a quite even split between men and women. Most of the people are fully employed, 92%, 5% are part-time employed. There are some people also and 32 nationalities are covered, 17 developing countries, four former Soviet Republic, and 11 countries coming from developing countries. Now, if you look at the other alumni, most of the people that were coming from the other alumni were Dutch, 43%, and if you count Dutch, German, and Belgium, I think we have something like 95% of the people, so it was really a very heavy concentration. Distribution of the location, of the geographical location of the students. Well, this is, we have plotted this map, and we were very proud of the map. But this means the nationality of the students that has completed from the 41, only from the 41. So if you see, there are many more nationalities that are involved in the program, but this is what we have covered, and we have already some graduates from that. Okay? So it looks like we have covered most of the world.
world.
Now, we also look at the present and past affiliation. So we have looked from those students where they have been working, okay? And if they have been working in any of the countries, we have used the column. Now you see that the concentration toward Europe is a little bit Europe and the developed countries. So this comes as a conclusion also to our studies. Like, we do take people from all the world, but it seems we, once they graduate, most of them are captured or absorbed by the developed world, part of the world. The situation is even stronger if we look at Europe, because you will see actually that the people are mostly working on Western Europe, so they are not even, even though they are coming from everywhere, they end up working in the same place. So this is kind of funny, but at the same time it's kind of worrying, because it means, you know, if the intention is to develop and to expand a little bit the knowledge that we have, there is something that is not really working on the right way, and maybe we should think about why people are not actually working where they are coming from, if that was the intention. So this is my part of the presentation, and my work. Semi will continue with the other.
Okay. So we had a part in the survey, so we asked former students, so now they are PhDs, to name at most 10 social and 10 scientific contacts. Okay. There are 49 students who answered the survey out of 86 students that we sent the survey. So these are the results in a nutshell. So what we did is we took names in the social network and names in the scientific network. We merged them together, okay? So there are 128 unique names. And you can see the distribution here. There are 32 MERIT PhDs, there are 24 other PhDs, 36 researchers, 22 students, current students, 6 admin staff, and 7 people that we don't know who they are. This was one of the mysterious things that came up during the analysis. I will ask some people to locate, you know, like forest people. So on average, 3.3 social contacts and 2.7 scientific contacts, but these are within MERIT contacts, okay? It's a close community. There are strong cohort and time effects. I'll come to that in a bit. And this doesn't really matter. So no significant difference among students in Europe and outside Europe in terms of number of social and scientific contacts. Okay, so there are some numbers here. So there's a strong PhD cohort effect, meaning that PhDs who are involved in the program have much more social and scientific contacts, okay? Compared to this other alumni group. And there's also a strong time effect, and this is something that's kind of expected. PhDs who defended their thesis recently have more social and scientific contacts, but in both the PhD cohort and the time, effects are stronger for social contacts. So if you compare the numbers here, on this column you see that they do not change that much. But here, for different groups, the numbers change quite a lot. But what was really interesting to see in the social network and scientific network analysis that there are 13 PhDs with 0 contacts. So this was kind of surprising for us, because there was a control question, so we specifically asked, do we have social contacts? It's a yes-no question. If you say yes, you have some other questions. If you say no, you skip the questions. So they really say no to this question. It's not by not naming the people. What I did is that I really looked at these people, further investigated PhDs who are involved in this UNU-MERIT PhD program. And I looked at, first for the social contacts, what I did is, I looked at people, so my cohort, for instance, it's one before me and one after me, okay? So that's plus one and minus one. So 47% of the contacts was, actually it's a cohort effect. So I only communicate with people in my cohort, plus one, minus one. 29% with researchers who are mostly supervisors. So not other researchers, but in my case, it's Pierre and us, who are mostly supervisors and in the management, so it's also Luke, Bart, and Robin. But if you look at the scientific contacts, it's just the other way around. So it's 56% with researchers, and only 70% with co-workers.
Okay. So students do have social contacts and on boards or even within boards, but it's rare that they collaborate on scientific research. So only nine students named a fellow board student as a scientific contact, and I also checked the reason, and it's generally for organizing a conference, so not really writing a paper. Let's skip this. So this is the network we have. So one thing to explain. As you can see, for instance, here, there are a lot of people who think that are not connected. But since I merged all the names, so there is 126 names. So probably some of the names do not really appear in a scientific network. So it doesn't really mean that we are not connected. So what do we know? Social network, denser, as you can see, compared to the graph below. There are more connections, there are more people. There is only one disconnected cluster. So there are three people who are really connected, but they are not connected to any other people on the wider network. Here you can also see administrative staff connected well. These gray, you cannot really probably see. So they are really strong in network, in a social network. In the scientific network, this is not so dense, meaning that there are fewer connections, there are fewer people. There are four disconnected clusters, so there are more people that are working kind of to each other, but they are not really connected to the rest of the people. And administrative staff is kind of loosely connected here. And I have more results on the social network at Focus. So it's a denser. So what I do is so the size of the circles, these nodes, so these are all person. They reflect this between centrality, meaning that how important are they in the information flow. Okay. As you can see, there are no names. It's not because of ethical reasons, because we have seen a business opportunity here. So if you give us €5, I'll tell you where you are. So the dominance of merit creation is here. As you can see, there are a lot of new people who are really good, good position in social network, in the information flows. So all subgroups are kind of represented here. So there's a vibrant within and between subgroup connections. So you can see blue, light blue, red, yellow, gray. You know, all groups are kind of presented here. Admin staff representative, as strong as a researcher or an early PhD. So there is this admin staff. I'm not going to tell. So the social network of merit PhD is much more vibrant, that includes all of the subgroups and particularly important. So if you look at the scientific network, things are a bit different. Now you see the dominant guys are the researchers. Okay? So we, as merit PhDs, have some contact with each other, but actually the information flows through the researchers. So not among the through the PhD group. So this is a less denser compared to the social network graph. The dominance of researchers here in social network was merit PhDs. Mostly researchers and merit PhDs. So you only see the blue people here or the red people here, and the others are kind of wiped out from the network. So the merit PhDs rely on the scientific network. They deal with fellow cohorts and supervisors and lectures, and I think this continues for a long time. So even in my case, for instance, I kind of feel this. So I talk with people who are more or less in my cohort, maybe one plus, one minus, and then my supervisors, but not a lot of people in the industry. So, suggestions? You want to go?
We have some sense, so we thought that it would be a good opportunity to do something now that we are all here together. So we were thinking that maybe we should do something to strengthen a little bit the relation among the alumni. So we are open to suggestions, but it would be nice at least to have a list of the people who have been part of the PhD program. Now we have a list of people who have completed the PhD program, but we have like many people who are like in the way, you know, so we have no connection. No database, so it would be nice maybe to make, we were thinking maybe a LinkedIn group or I don't know, WhatsApp group, whatever, so that we can get together a little bit closer, because I remember that, I mean, I spent a lot of time with Semi, but there was like 5 years in the middle of, after I completed the PhD, that maybe he didn't talk to me. So there was like, what is happening, you know, maybe we should create more interaction among ourselves to do something which is a bit useful. Sometimes we have also, we were thinking that maybe the information flow is not so fluent among the network, so it's true that there is a newsletter, but I don't think that everybody that was a PhD student knows what is going on in UNU-MERIT right now, whether there are conferences, whether something is happening in the institute. So maybe we should do something that at least we get an email once a month to know, okay, this is, maybe you should register, but maybe we are too lazy to do, or I don't know. We can do, think about something. Another opportunity would be maybe to have more of this kind of periodic conferences, workshops that allow us to collaborate and interact a little bit more. And we are open to more suggestions. And with this, I think we have completed the presentation. But I wanted to say, before finishing, I wanted to thank everybody. Mostly, you know, researcher, Robin, everybody who took care of us, because it was really a very nice experience. And I think everybody is very, once you went through the experience, your life really changed, and this we appreciate. From, and I'm taking the word from most of the students that I know, so I don't know if it's the same for everybody, but we wanted to say thank you from the student side. Okay.